The next one is also a family poem. And this poem, this is the last, this is a poem that came to me, or at least the start of it, in an emergency room in a hospital. Where I was waiting for a specialist to come, and I had been moved out of the, I'm okay, you know, if you're wondering. I was moved out of the waiting area, and I was in the corridor on a gurney, lying back, just waiting. If I had the power not to inflict any such experience on you, I would call on it right now. Never be in this, especially at late at night. Mm-hmm. Is it 11? Is it 1? Is it 3? Is it 4? You lose a sense of time. The weird environment is so awful. And plus, no one makes eye contact with you, because then they'd have to have an exchange. Instead, they're just scuttling around, ignoring you, and then suddenly asking you if you want orange juice or something. You know, it's just, it's a nightmare of a situation. You feel lost. You feel a little bit nuts, right? People have their routines, doctors come, people change shifts, new patients are wheeled in, but they disappear. You know, all of that happens. It's a terrible thing. And then one of the patients says, clearly, but with no context whatsoever, "This week's China!" I heard that phrase. And I thought, oh, I was in a state of, on a feeling I was in a crazy world, and that, that I was actually feeling the most useless anger and frustration I've ever felt in my life. Maybe that's what I'm hoping you don't have to feel, in that funny, suspended state in a waiting room, in an emergency room. Then, through the title of the poem, which is called This Week's China, came the following poem. I'll read it to you, and then I'll say some things that I think will show you the way this is indeed a family poem. It might not seem so superficially. It's on page 26. Oh, I have to tell you two things, because you don't have it in front of you, most of you. When This Week's China, of course, it's capital C in the title, right? When it actually appears in the poem, it's going to have a little C on it. It's dishes. It's dishes, all right? That was one of my great jokes, and I have to just I have to spoil it for you. I'm so sorry. And another is this: just also, if you were reading on your own, you'd be able to pause and figure something out. But since there's no time to pause, I'll tell you that there's a reference to a museum. There's an important museum in this poem. But all the museum is a collection of memories. It's a repository of memories. That's all it is. There is no physical museum to be encountered in This Week's China. Here we go. Aunt Renee was expert in betrayal. Uncle Jack stood up and swore "I do," and then before you knew it, left her holding a full-grown baby and a fat monthly debt. But she lived and learned, and life went on until Uncle Henry, her own personal savior and Judas all in one, ha-ha, did just about the same. The prince, who called himself a family man, and said it was her turn now to feel like royalty. So that settled any doubt. Uncle Jack and Uncle Henry became twin king tuts in a private museum that practically built itself. Portable, secure yet open all hours for guided tours featuring the two old standbys, but first, items recently acquired. This unkept date, that unappreciated sandwich, this unanswered prayer or phone call, lean in close to take in the detail, that unreturned handbag, smile, friendship. Back at the entrance, where it was time to be reminded of the precise value of the show, Aunt Renee's eyes, sharp and searching then, seemed to direct its meaning straight at me. Look how easily a promise made is broken, even if it's forged in steel. Then a shrug of the shoulders and brows to punctuate futility, and bitter final words I loved, and silently said with her, "This week's China." Toward the end, the museum closed. On short notice, Aunt Renee retired. behind grudging speech and a blank gaze that leveled everything before it. Us, the changing sky, rooms ever smaller, those graying tiles and fluorescent lights, and frightened everyone but me. Aunt Renee, I thought, had liquidated all her holdings, exchanged them for a kind of song, sustaining, sounding just for her. The music played and shuffled and played again, of the sudden shattering of a bowl, the crash of bursting glass, the rude bang of a blowout, the ripping of a sleeve on a latch, the soft splintering of ice beneath the feet. And if she's lucky, peace be with you, Aunt Renee, the bright clanging of a pearly gate. That's it. Well, now a full disclosure that I will only make to this crowd. Hold on to your hats, your seats. For most of the writing of this poem, until the very end, when I decided to make an adjustment, it wasn't Aunt Renee, it was Aunt Marie. Mm-hmm. And here's why, all right? It was because when we were growing up, Aunt Marie would sort of assemble us, and with a sharpness or vivacity in her eyes, they were dark, they were sharp and searching then, she would tell us secrets. You know what I mean? That's how I learned the pleasure of secrets. Was from Aunt Marie. And her attitude really was, oh, look at the human spectacle. What a bunch of, you know, there was some malice in it, some, but most of it, I think, was she had a huge perspective on life, and human foibles just sort of tickled her, and she would just sort of bring them out and would share this joy in the foibles of human life. Caroline talked about this. Later, she softened some, and I think that the sort of a smaller spirit expanded. Marie, we agree, had a great soul. And at the end, when she would assemble us and hear her stories and tell stories, it was from a sort of wonder at human foibles, the human spectacle. It displayed a kind of largeness that she had, and that we thought was a wonderful kind of development in her personality. I hope this makes sense to you. It was part of our experience, at least. And I want to tell you this exactly. The point where she shifted, I think, if there was a fulcrum, it was on the point of Robin's death. Robin, who died of HIV/AIDS, whom she loved, really, was a kind of son. And when that happened, Aunt Marie no longer sort of whispered or talked about funny bunnies and stuff like that. No one was going to talk that way about Robin or that way of being ever again. And in some way, I think she sort of stood up and started to become, and through other means too, a larger person. I was going to call her Aunt Marie and then put a footnote there so that all the family, I put all that I just said to you in a footnote so that you wouldn't think this was Aunt Marie. This is just a name that I used. But I realized there's no footnote that accommodate that, and it would sound like a sort of nutty thing to do. So at some point I changed it to Aunt Renee, which sounds enough to me like that, and has an accent in it, which sort of makes for the comedy. Because here's why I'm telling you all this, a second reason. The original idea for this poem was more comic, and I think you can hear that in the opening, where this is a kind of coarse woman who gets some bad experiences and responds in a not a very subtle way to the things that are inflicted on her. But once I named her Aunt Marie, my feelings about this character changed, and you might notice that as it develops, affection emerges, and I'm actually present in the poem. I was never going to be at first. But I somehow felt the need to show me at her feet sort of responding to this and being delighted. And when she says this week's China or this week's betrayal, sort of enjoying the idiosyncrasies of this aunt, who is now just Aunt Renee. And the original idea for the poem, even worse, I'm kind of embarrassed about this now, was that she was going to be betrayed all her life, complaining all her life, with thinking she's going to have heaven as a reward, but when she gets up there, the gate slams in her face. Ha ha ha. This was going to be the capping bit of humor in this poem. But since my feelings have been modified, I think something much subtler happens, and that is these sounds that could have tormented her, I try to imagine as a kind of music, of the crashing, the china, the bangs, the blowouts, the whatever, actually had a soothing effect. Somehow I wanted that to be hers, and that finally in the end she would be granted escape in a heavenly setting. I will leave you with this. I think all of us know what it feels like to be trapped by bitterness and resentment. We all know what it feels like to be trapped. There's no escape. You disappoint yourself. You go insane with these horrible feelings, but you can't escape them, right? We also know loved ones and friends who are in those states temporarily. You see them. They may try to come to you for help with them, but you can't help them because it's a trap, right? Of bitterness and resentment. Now, sometimes, of course, you can wish that loved one in hell, right? Because it can be so awful to witness and so painful to ask sympathy for. But in other states, you can wish this person in heaven. You can wish this person a peace that they don't have and that you just wish they could achieve and that it was in your power to bestow. And that's the spirit of this poem. Finally, yeah. That's it. That's a group of family poems for you, just selected just for you. Although I find the family poems seem to resonate with any listener faster than any other poem, even if they don't know me and my family. They just seem to... Well, someone said, yeah, of course they do. We've all had parents. Which I guess makes sense, you know. So their problems, forms of regret or loss or a painful memory. Unfortunately, those lost memory regrets, somehow they lend themselves to poetic treatment. I think they just naturally the subjects of poems, at least the ones that inspire me to do.